was a little music for you, a little guitar music. And hello everybody, this is the last video for those micro groups that are preparing for the micro test, the third micro test on monopoly, oligopoly, and monopolistic competition. I'm going to go through at least one of the last two articles in the packet that I had distributed a couple weeks ago. And I opened the videos with this little advisory there. Please read those last two articles, Shake Up in Light Trucks and The Really Real Thing. One's about the light truck market and the other's about Coca-Cola and Pepsi and water. So if you didn't pause already and read the articles, I suggest you do now, and because I want to get going and try to help you understand those articles. All right. The one about the pickup trucks is one you can learn a lot from about how oligopolies operate in the modern world. And so I'm going to try to give you a little analysis of the article and try to learn what we can about real life oligopolies and what they can do that firms and other more competitive markets really can't do. So at any rate, you finished through this article. It talks about new marketing, hybrids, and small specialized runs have a big impact. Now, this article was written in 1999. Hybrids in those days didn't mean what hybrids means now. Hybrid cars now refer to the cars that have the ability to run on electric and gasoline. Hybrid as a word just means a combination of two things. And so what it's referring to here is a trend in the pickup market where they grab features from cars or grab features from trucks and put them all together in a new sort of model. And I'm just going to read the first paragraph. Struggling with slimmer profit margins and overcapacity in the light truck market, automakers are rushing to craft new strategies to keep the sizzle going. All right? Right from the first paragraph, you should sense that there was a brief period or maybe an extended period where the profits were starting to weaken for these manufacturers, Ford, Chevy, Nissan, and others. And struggling with slimmer profit margins means maybe the profits were normalizing, something that maybe their market shares were just holding steady but not growing, which is what they'd like to have happen. And now they're trying to either market or develop some new lines and use some product differentiation to try to gain market share and increase revenues and profits. The ideas range from rushing out products that create new segments to marketing the same old trucks in new ways. The result could be the biggest shakeup in the light truck market since the four-door sport utility craze in the early 90s. So we all know what an SUV is. So I'm going to assume that you've read through the article, not just the first two paragraphs. The standard question to open the test, the essay section of the test, is to say, what is the market? And in this case, that's a pretty hard thing to do because of this whole matter of hybrids and new segments and understanding exactly what that means. So just in defining the market is where tons of analysis can be done, useful analysis and useful learning. All right, so I'm going to go through as broad an outline as I can about the car market and let you see how this particular article and this story or event in the car market comes in a context and follows a pattern. It's a pattern that you see a lot in oligopoly. So there's a car market, right? And there's a truck market, but so many trucks are commercial vehicles and big trucks. So how do you handle narrowing in on the specific market that the article is talking about? Well, let's just say let's just say we got a market for four-wheeled vehicles. Any vehicle with four wheels. That way we can include the vans that are referenced in here, or we will reference, four-wheeled vehicles. So that's an E. And we can include some of the things that they talk about here that we might miss. So from the four-wheeled vehicle category, a big broad category, there's obviously cars, there's vans, and there's pickup trucks. Pickup trucks used to be commercial vehicles. Vans used to be commercial vehicles. But things have changed over many, many years. If I asked you about categories for cars, and I always do when I do this lecture in class, people start mentioning all the things. Oh, well, there's sports cars. That's a segment, to use the vocabulary of the article. There's economy cars, you know, very small cars that are very good on gas. Compact cars, you might call them. All right, there's that category. There's sedans. You know, the traditional family car. What else? People talk about coupes. Maybe that's like a subcategory of sports cars, but, you know. There are luxury cars. Luxury cars. What else? Well, you know, once upon a time, there were station wagons. Station wagons. You don't see many station wagons anymore, but when I was a youngster, many families had them. That's typically what families had, sedans and station wagons. So it seemed like every other house on the block had them. All right. What happened to the station wagon? At one point, profit margins began to get slimmer and slimmer. And it's at those junctures that auto manufacturers, any firm in any market, start to think, we got to do something different in order to improve profitability. So what they did in the 1980s is borrowed from another category, a completely different category that wouldn't necessarily be associated with the one we're concerned with, say cars. They developed in the 80s the minivans. And you could consider them a kind of hybrid because they were a little like vans, obviously, because they were shaped like vans. And they were bigger than cars. But they sized them down, so to speak, and aimed for a new client to buy the vans or the minivans. That's a new segment. And they're trying to use this new segment to shift traditional customers over to a new category, which would be more profitable than the old category. All right? Now, in the context of oligopoly, where firms compete for market share, this is a difficult sort of gamble. Although they do things to make sure the gamble pays off to the best extent possible. Let me put it to you this way. First of all, there's certainly a chance that what they're introducing will not turn out to be popular. And if the minivans don't, you know, take off, then they've created a whole new category, expended a lot of capital cost, essentially like startup cost for a new type of vehicle, and then it fell flat on its face. That's an obvious loss. That's like a case five, a new product that didn't, you know, meet any success, any commercial success. All right, so what if it does well? Well, let's say Ford introduces a new minivan, right? I think they did, I think it was called the Windstar. If it can acquire customers not just from Ford itself and the buyers of station wagons, its buyers of station wagons, if it can grab persons that drive Chevy station wagons, Dodge station wagons, maybe even foreign cars that sold them station wagons at the time, though I don't think there were many, maybe like a Volkswagen or maybe even like a Jeep customer. If they can get those customers from other companies to buy, say, a Ford minivan, well, that's like the best success they can possibly have, because they're grabbing market share from other companies and meeting, you know, the profit goals and aspirations that they had for the new segment. As it gets more and more popular, this becomes a distinct category, and that category replaces the old category. Of course, this depends in part on that, you know, having Ford itself, say it's Ford, switching its customers to the minivans, which are more profitable, and they are strategically priced to be more profitable. So it's almost as though they're taking this customer and trying to move them up, you see? And move them up is an important concept, because let's just say they introduced the Ford Windstar, and it doesn't grab any new clients from Chevy, Dodge, or Chrysler, or what have you. Ford buyers start getting the minivans. If all that happens is Ford loses sales on the station wagons and gains sales on the Windstar, say, that's not necessarily a big gain. In fact, it's one of those situations where you would use the word cannibalize. You know, if all the minivan does is replace buyers from the Ford station wagons, that may not be such a great success, especially if the rate of profit for the two cars is the same. But what the companies will do to protect themselves from that event is price this higher, make it distinct, and price it higher so that when customers move over, they at least get a higher rate of return than from the traditional purchase. Then if it comes to pass that Dodge buyers are coming in to buy the Ford Windstar, and Jeep buyers are, and Chevy buyers are, and all the others, well, then they're gaining market share to boot. So there's a manipulation of two things, the price and profit margin, so that it ensures profitability for the new vehicle, the new product, and the aspiration the company has to gain market share vis-a-vis its other competitors. So that was done in the 80s, and that worked for a while. I know in class we've referenced product cycle once or twice, and you know, this new minivan will have a product cycle, and the product cycle will be determined by the very popularity it proves to have, and when the company finally thinks its potential for profits is maximized from this new segment. But to establish a new segment is in itself pretty, you know, a pretty successful accomplishment. So, what happens for an Encore? What happened in the 90s are the SUVs. SUVs sort of started borrowing from trucks. And I think technically SUVs are trucks. Something about the platform and the chassis and the size of it really makes it properly considered a truck. Although it's not marketed as a truck, it's marketed to family buyers. So the SUVs, that's right, okay. SUVs were meant and designed purposely to replace minivans and have people switch over to those cars. And these were priced in a way that they would be insured a profit margin even better than what existed for minivans. Because maybe after a 10-year run of minivans, this profit margin began to fall because they couldn't maintain that sort of cachet and you know, popularity with the minivans. It's sort of, the product cycle ran its course. So they thought of something new. In the environment of the 90s where gas was cheap, they went in the direction of minivans. SUVs, right? And it's borrowed from another category, like I say, the trucks. Obviously, this new segment was very, very successful for the 90s, all right? But again, introducing a new category runs the risk of merely cannibalizing. That is to say, the company introduces a line of cars, a product differentiation, potentially a new segment, that just takes away from sales of its own other product line. That doesn't sound too good unless they strategically price it in a certain way. A way that will obviously be higher to ensure a certain profit margin, a desirable profit margin. And again, if it takes away customers from other companies, then it's even more successful. All right, so the third paragraph then sort of encapsulates the whole story of this article. We see this historic trend from the 80s with minivans and then the 90s with SUVs. And here comes the third paragraph. The most eye-catching shift in the truck market will be the onslaught of sport utility pickups and light-duty pickups with four-car-like doors. These hybrids, combinations that is, constitute an entirely new segment that will either cannibalize sport utility sales and pickup sales or expand the market. Either way, the impact could be substantial. So that paragraph is saying essentially what I'm trying to say. Here we go with something new. You know, in between, towards the tail end of the 90s, SUVs sort of began to split up from regular SUVs to luxury SUVs. So that luxury cars and features of the luxury cars were put in the SUVs, all right? In fact, one little interesting story about the SUVs is the Cadillac story. Cadillac had been a traditional coupe de ville, you know, big gas-guzzling car, huge sedans that only rich people bought. And the SUVs got real popular in the 90s, and I remember reading an article where the chief executive officer of Cadillac said, over my dead body, are we going to make SUVs? He didn't want to go into it, all right, into that segment. About a month later, that chief executive officer for Cadillac was fired, and the new one was put out there to say, Cadillac is going to introduce an SUV. Cadillac was a very late entrant into the luxury SUV model and line, into that part of the competition. And as you know, it's become very successful. But it was very lucky, because Cadillac was really on its last leg and could have gone into a case 5 shutdown. But they took one more chance, introduced the luxury SUV, and it became very popular. It pretty much saved the company. But, you know, they were really following the lead of the Lexus SUVs and things like that, those sort of companies that were developing that. At any rate, back to the original case. So now they're going to use SUV features and pickup features to make a whole new segment that, in a way, doesn't have a name besides hybrid, right? So the three cars that are mentioned in the little picture there, Ford Explorer Sport Track. So it's not an Explorer, it's a Sport Track Explorer. The Chevy Extreme, the Nissan Frontier Crew Cab. As the article progresses, it talks about, you know, using Harley Davidson insignias and features, or, you know, insignias to place on the car, all sorts of marketing gimmicks to try to make whatever the brand is distinct in this, you know, growing in segmentation of these of this, you know, sport utility and pickup market. So there's